What would it sound like if a monkey proposed?
Will you marry me?
How would an elephant call your name? Can parrots really speak? And does the giraffe have anything to say at all? You're about to find out as we explore the spoken language of the animal kingdom. It's time to talk with the animals in another RobWords. These are the Barbary macaques at Berlin's Tierpark Zoo. Did you know that no non-human primate has ever been taught to speak? You've perhaps seen videos of Nim Chimpsky, the chimpanzee who was raised to use American Sign Language, and other members of that species have found remarkable ways to communicate with us.
Tim, please tickle Lana. Yes, replies Tim.
Come here, Lana, come here.
That's absolutely incredible, isn't it? But it's not speech. It's not vocal language. And one of the reasons that a chimpanzee has never said a word is that their anatomy makes it basically impossible. They lack the long vocal tracts that we have, the versatile tongues for shaping the sounds, and also the mouths that we have, which are kind of small, but enable us to control the noises we make with incredible precision, when you think about it. But they also don't appear to have the neural wiring that allows us to make these complex, voluntary sounds on demand. However, research conducted within the last decade suggests some primates, if they could get over that sizable neurological hurdle, might be physically speech ready. In 2016, researchers set out to challenge the idea that monkeys, specifically macaques, like we have here at the Tierpark, couldn't speak if they wanted to. So instead of, as had been previously done, poking around the vocal tracts of dead or sedated monkeys, they took X-ray footage of macaques doing various things like eating and making sounds. And from that, they tried to work out what sounds the macaque might be capable of making given the amount of different movements that their vocal tract and their mouth could actually perform. And what they concluded was that it was a lot. They said if a macaque monkey had a brain capable of vocal learning and combinatoric operations over speech sounds, its vocal tract would be able to produce clearly intelligible speech. So the researchers reckoned that the macaques would be able to make, for a start, 5 different vowel sounds, which maybe doesn't sound like very much. English has a lot more than 5, but actually 5 vowel sounds is around about the average for languages around the world. So that wouldn't get in the way of them being understood by humans. They also reckoned that they'd be able to produce quite a lot of consonant sounds as well, what are called stop consonants, like k and g, like that. And then other sounds as well, like w and m, they'd have been capable of producing those. So you might be wondering, if a macaque could talk, what would it sound like? Well, the researchers anticipated that question and attempted to recreate that sound. I'm going to warn you here, this is creepy. This is what a macaque would sound like if it got down on one tiny knee and proposed.
Will you marry me?
And again?
Will you marry me?
Yeah, like I say, a bit creepy. And did you also detect a slight sort of accent in there?
Will you marry me?
Now that's because of what I was talking about the vowel sounds. So English has anywhere between sort of 15 and 20 something vowel sounds, depending on who you ask. And so if a macaque could only actually produce 5 vowel sounds, it would have to reappropriate some of those sounds and apply them to some of our vowel sounds that it doesn't have. And that's how you end up with a macaque that sounds a little bit exotic.
Will you marry me?
It's comprehensible, isn't it? But it is also extremely hypothetical. These macaques might have speech-ready bodies, but they do not have speech-ready brains. So let's talk about some of the remarkable things that some monkeys already do, because they are worth talking about. These are vervet monkeys, and unusually for monkeys, they like to spend their time on the ground. But that makes them susceptible to threats that other monkeys are less likely to experience. However, they've come up with a very clever way to deal with that additional threat. This lookout vervet will make a different sound depending on what the danger is. For example, this sound means, snake, watch out, stand up and look down. This sound means, watch out, eagle, get deep into the trees where the birds can't fly at you. And this sound says, careful, leopard, get into the trees and get to the end of the branches so that big cat can't grab you. Each of these sounds carries a different meaning and triggers a different behavior, making them almost like words. However, almost is the key word there, because they are not words, for reasons that I will explain. Now, when you think of whale song, you perhaps think of this. However, they don't all communicate like that. Sperm whales, for example, communicate exclusively with clicks. And an amazing bit of new research suggests that what they do with those clicks might be remarkably similar to something that humans do. Thanks to this video's sponsor, Ground News, I can see that researchers at UC Berkeley studied around 9,000 recordings using AI models described as ChatGPT for whales to identify vocal patterns. And what they concluded was that sperm whale clicks appear to work like the vibrations that create human vowel sounds, just much slower. It challenges the previous idea that these clicks were some sort of Morse code. Pretty cool. Ground News is a website and app that brings together news sources from around the world and helps you to understand the coverage. On the sperm whale story alone, it found 18 articles, and for each one, it tells us important information about the outlet, such as who owns it, any potential political bias, and most importantly, how reliable it is. For example, it rates Smithsonian Mag as very high factuality, meaning you can have confidence when reading it. I've been working with Ground News for years now because I think it's never been more important to understand who your news sources are and whether they can be trusted. And Ground News gives you all of the tools you need to do that. If you want to get access to it, go to ground.news/robwords or use my QR code to get 40% off the Vantage plan, which is what I use. That's around $5 a month. Give it a go. So we've heard how macaques might be able to make sounds like humans, and how the clicks of sperm whales are like a very slow vowel movement. But there are animals that can produce sounds that sound almost exactly like human speech. In fact, they can be indistinguishable. I'm talking about birds. Now, I was hoping to show you a few here at the Tier Park, but because of an outbreak of bird flu in Europe, they've kept them all safely inside. However, let's talk about these guys. Let's talk about parrots. Because parrots are the closest thing we have to a non-human animal that can speak. Would you like to hear an African grey parrot reciting parts of the Quran in Arabic? Yes? Here you go. An even more impressive African grey called Alex is said to have been the first non-human to ask an existential question when one day he looked in the mirror and said, "What colour?" The answer was grey. So parrots can produce speech-like sounds, but they do it in a different way to we do it. So we have a larynx at the top of our trachea, right? So we have air that goes up and then through the voice box and then out through our mouths, and that's how we make sounds. Birds have something else. They have something called a syrinx instead of a larynx, which sits at the bottom of the trachea and manipulates the sound down there before sending it up through the windpipe. And usually that comes out as a squawk or whatever. But with parrots, they, like us, have very versatile tongues that can further manipulate the sound. And they have beaks that they can open or close just about as much as they want, again, giving them more control over the sound. This means they can essentially talk, but they're not talking. Now, Alex was sadly cut down in his prime in 2007 at the age of just 31. They can live twice as long as that. He had more to learn. But his legacy was leaving linguists to reassess whether humans really are the only animals that can truly speak. So let's talk about what human language does that other animals don't achieve, because linguists have put a lot of thought into this. Back in 1960, a fellow called Charles Hockett proposed 13 design features for language. It was a list of 13 things that make languages languages. Now, nowadays they are best described as features of spoken language, because in the 65 years since Hockett published his list, sign languages have been rightly recognized as fully fledged languages, despite not having all of these features. Now, Hockett didn't intend his list to be used to compare humans and other animals, but by looking at it, we can see that there is at the very least a trio of these 13 features that no non-human species has managed to nail down. Firstly, what he called traditional transmission. Languages are transmitted non-genetically by social learning and teaching, whereas animals, their noises tend to be wired in, they're instinctive. Though we have taught other animals to say things, they haven't taught these things to each other. The second feature is displacement. This is a really key one. It's the ability to talk about things that are not present in the here and now. Humans can say, "I saw a dog yesterday." Other animals cannot. And a third is productivity, the fact that human language is inexhaustive. I can right now say a sentence that has never been uttered before. My ginormous aardvark just bikini waxed a bison. And what's more, you can understand it. The possibilities are endless, whereas with animal sounds, they're limited to a specific repertoire. At the same time, that repertoire can be pretty impressive. Some animals are capable of noises that we couldn't even dream of. Elephants, for example, can produce sounds so deep that we can't even hear them, let alone replicate them. I'm going to come out of there because it's a bit silly. But when you think of elephants, you probably think of trumpeting trunks. But that's not actually the sound that keeps elephant societies together. That is the elephant rumble. Elephants produce deep grumbling sounds that can travel huge distances and say things like, "Hey, I'm over here," to other elephants in the vicinity, or, "Guys, it's time to go," when the herd has finished its brief stop at the watering hole. But what's amazing about these rumbles is that often they are infrasonic. That means they occur at frequencies that are below the levels that humans can hear. We know when they're being made a lot of the time because they produce harmonics that we actually can hear, but the sounds themselves, most of it, is inaudible to human beings. But recent research suggests that one of the things the elephants are doing with these rumbles is remarkably human-like. It suggests they're calling each other by name. The researchers at Colorado State University said that African elephants address one another with individually specific name-like calls. I'll allow them to explain.
We played back calls that we had high confidence that had names and calls that we had high confidence that they weren't labeled. And we played those back to individuals. And we found responses to the calls that we assumed had a good chance of vocal labeling.
Not only that, but when the elephant was played a clip that featured the name of a different elephant, they just ignored it because it wasn't addressed to them. Now, with all this name stuff, you might be thinking, yeah, well, other species do that too. Well, yeah, but no, not like this, they don't. Dolphins and parrots call each other by name, by actually imitating the signature call of the addressee. It's like calling Homer Simpson "Dol" instead of calling him Homer. But what elephants are doing is creating these abstract sounds to refer to specific individuals. It's amazing because it's what we do. That's exciting, isn't it? But you know what else is exciting? That I am doing my first ever live show. RobWords Live is coming to London's Bloomsbury Theatre on the 11th of April 2026. I'm extremely excited about it. It's going to be an evening of etymology and general word nerdery. If you want to join me for it and let me see that lovely face of yours, I'll leave a link below to where you can buy tickets. Come join me for RobWords Live. Now, if you spend a lot of time in the forest, as I clearly do, you'll be well aware of the call of the red deer. However, did you know that red deer stags actually have two types of calls? They have what zoologists call their common roar, the one, unsurprisingly, they use most often. And they also have their harsh roar, which is the one that they use a bit more sparingly. It's, as the name suggests, harsher on the ears and is most likely used for grabbing the attention of ladies during the rut. I don't know why I said that in a sexy way. The common roar is actually really fascinating, though, because it is distinct to the individual, and intrinsic to the sound is objective information about the stag who is emitting it, including an honest appraisal of the stag's size. That means that despite the image we like to think of stags going antler to antler, they actually don't come to blows as often as they might, because from the roars alone, two stags can establish who would win if they did fight. And usually that's enough to encourage the lesser stag to just, you know, leave it out. So a roaring stag might seem like it's spoiling for a fight, but actually it might just be trying to avoid one. So the stag roars, the elephant trumpets or grumbles, the cat meows and the dog barks, but what does the giraffe do? Well, let's talk about an animal from whom we barely hear a peep, because actually giraffes are capable of making sounds. Well, firstly, they can snort, they can produce bursts, and as this video shot right here at Berlin's Tierpark shows, they can also grunt. Just listen carefully for it. But it is true that you'll very rarely hear an adult giraffe make a sound. And that's weird, because giraffes are pretty sociable animals, and animals with similar social structures like elephants can barely keep a lid on it. So what's the deal with giraffes? Well, it was thought that one of the reasons they don't make a lot of sounds is that they can't, because of their long necks, it somehow makes getting the sound up and out there a bit harder. And it's also thought that maybe they're doing what I was saying elephants do, which is make ultrasonic sounds that we can't hear. There are certain movements that giraffes make that seem a little bit bizarre, but some zoologists think might be associated with production of a noise that our ears don't pick up. However, research carried out here in Berlin and at two other zoos in Copenhagen and Vienna found that giraffes were making another noise that we previously didn't know about. They were humming to one another. The researchers set up microphones in the stalls where they put the giraffes here at night, and they recorded hundreds of hours of audio. And in among those hundreds of hours of basically silence, they heard this. Okay, so it sounds like someone having trouble on the toilet in the middle of the night. But that sound is remarkable, and it only occurs 65 times in the 900 hours of audio that the researchers recorded. But they describe that hum as probably a contact call, a sound made by the giraffes to reassure each other from their separate stalls that they're still there. So the lion roars, the elephant trumpets, and the giraffe does what? Well, it hums. And that brings to an end our conversation with the animal kingdom. But one key question remains, doesn't it? If animals can't speak, why can we? Well, that's a question that I will answer on this channel in the coming months, so do keep an eye out for that. Thanks to Tierpark Berlin, Colorado State University, and Professor Julian Pine from Liverpool University for all their help with this video. Thanks to you for watching it as well. I recommend you maybe watch this one next. Check out Ground News and, of course, RobWords live tickets in the links below. And until next time, take care.